Good morning, good morning. Welcome to the Carb Cycling Workshop. In today's workshop, I'm going to be talking about what carb cycling is. I'll talk about who it's for, who it might benefit, how to know if you should be carb cycling, what I think, why I believe women should be carb cycling, different types of carb cycling, and then we'll take a little bit of a deeper dive into one very specific type, which is the type that or the form of carb cycling that I do most often, as well as the one that I recommend to my clients. So we are going to dig into it. Now, I will let you know right now that I have created a beautiful cheat sheet for you guys, a beautiful PDF, and I will let you know how to get your hands on that. You are more than welcome to take notes, but I've basically summarized everything I'm going to tell you guys today inside that cheat sheet, and I will let you know how to get your hands on it. Hello, I don't know if I'm going to say this right, Zahida? I believe. I hope I got that right. Hi, Donna. Please let me know if you are watching this live or if you are catching the replay. Just put it in the comments below, either live right now, tell me where you're from, or replay. And before I get into it, I would love to know, why are you intrigued about carb cycling? So what is it about carb cycling that you're interested in learning? So put that in the comments as well. And at the end, I will open it up for Q&A so that if I don't answer your question during the workshop, you will have the opportunity to ask at the end. Thank you, Donna, for letting me know that you are here. So once again, if you're just joining, I would love to know in the comments, A, if you're catching live or watching the replay, and B, what is it about carb cycling that interests you? Like, why are you interested? Is it because you're already doing low carb, but you find it too restrictive, or you're doing low carb and it's not working, or maybe you're doing low carb, but you feel like crap, like any of those, put it in the comments, let me know. From Mauritius, that is so cool that you're joining us. And Jane from the UK, Colleen, hello, hello. Becky is watching too. Caroline, awesome. Margarita, I hope I'm saying that right. I mean, you've got like the perfect name, hello. Natalie, so thank you, thank you. It's great to see you all. So let's jump in. So I'll just start by quickly telling you guys like how I discovered carb cycling. Hi, Bridget. I want to say Bridget because it's spelled like Bridget, but I know it's Bridget. Hi, Michelle. Okay, so carb cycling. So let me tell you about how I discovered it, first of all. So when I first got into the low carb world, I did keto, right? Like I went straight into keto, and I did keto for probably 2 to 3 months, and I felt amazing. I really loved it. I didn't lose much weight, but I didn't have much weight to lose. So, you know, that was not like, I wasn't surprised there. But after about 2 or 3 months, I can't remember what the timing was. Like I had read about carb cycling, but I was really nervous to incorporate it because I thought like, oh my God, if I have any carbs, it's going to spark, like it's going to be really hard to get back on track. And sure enough, the moment I reintroduced carbs after cutting them out for almost 3 months, I was like, yes, sweet potatoes. And I didn't want to go back to low carb. And it took me a really long time to kind of like, I would try and convince myself, okay, on Monday, I'm going to commit back to ketogenic, and I just couldn't do it. And that's when I realized, okay, I really need to give myself permission to not be as restrictive, not be so strict. And that's when I decided to really take on more of a carb cycling approach, which basically means that I eat low carb, healthy fats most of the time, or what some women would consider ketogenic. I do that most of the time, but I do incorporate carbohydrates strategically. So we'll talk about how I incorporate them, which ones I incorporate, how often I incorporate. We're going to talk about all of that. But simply, that's what carb cycling is. It's when you're alternating between a lower carb approach, and I would say a moderate carb approach. I'm not doing high carbs, I'm doing moderate carbs. And sometimes I do that daily, sometimes I do it weekly. You can do it cyclically with your period. You can do it cyclically with seasons. There's so many different ways to cycle carbs. But I think what it boils down to for me is recognizing that while too many carbs can be problematic, especially I think for women our age with insulin resistance, carbs aren't bad, right? They're not a bad food, especially if you're eating the right carbs. It really just depends on what you're going for. So we'll be talking a little bit about that today. So let's see what else I've got here. So Anna is joining us all the way from Puerto Rico. Very cool. Ready to learn. I suffer from hypothyroidism and keto and IF and want to change. All right, we're going to be talking about hypothyroidism. I'm doing low carb, but then I fail some of the times by either eating too much of the wrong thing. We're going to talk about that too. Jane, Kathy says, I'm 46 and menopause and having such a hard time losing weight, so want to learn more about this. Awesome. Well, this is a great strategy for sustainable weight loss, Kathy. Let's see. Anna says, 51, perimenopause, can't lose weight. Okay, so I probably won't be able to answer everything about weight loss and menopause in this one because we really are specifically talking about cycling carbs, but that's okay. You can always reach out to me. I've got lots of these videos and I can send you in the right direction. Okay, so one thing that I do want to point out when it comes to carb cycling and my approach is that carb cycling, it's not about, going low carb most of the time and then having meals where you're just like ice cream, chocolate, donuts, pizza, woohoo, chips, right? That's not what it's about. So again, it's really about trying to strategically incorporate whole complex carbohydrates into your diet periodically, okay? Now, within the sort of ketogenic community, not everybody agrees that carb cycling is the way to go. Like anything in nutrition, there's always a divide, right? And there are some ketogenic purists that believe that, you got to kind of stick to keto to really get the advantages of a ketogenic approach. But I would say more and more and more, this idea of cycling in and out of ketosis is gaining popularity, is gaining momentum. I'm reading a lot about how it benefits women in particular because we're just like a little bit more sensitive to stressors on the body, and low carb for too long can be one of those stressors. So it's gaining a lot of momentum. So I wanted to start by talking about just some of the women that this might benefit from. So this might be beneficial to you if you are following already a low carb approach or a ketogenic approach and you are not getting results. Like you've hit a plateau, nothing is moving, then this might be for you. If you are a woman in perimenopause or menopause and you suffer from insomnia, but you would like to try a low carb approach, this might be for you. If you are a woman who suffers with hypothyroidism or you're overstressed and you have potential adrenal fatigue issues, this is potentially for you. If you feel like keto is too restrictive and you are one of those women that falls off the wagon and then you get on the wagon and then you fall off the wagon, this is for you. If you are a woman who is very active, right? So maybe you do endurance training, maybe you go to CrossFit, you're a muscular woman, any of those, this is for you. Or maybe you even just want to build muscle mass. Maybe that is your priority. So your priority is not fat loss, but muscle mass, this is for you. So those are just some examples. Who it may not be for. So I do think that it's beneficial for almost everyone. Who it would not benefit is anyone who is doing a ketogenic approach for therapeutic reasons, right? So some women will use a ketogenic approach to, for example, as part of a cancer treatment. And then it's the ketones that are therapeutic, and you need to stay in ketosis to get those ketones. So if that is you, this might not be for you. The only other person that I would say this is not for, and it is for you, but you may just need a little bit of coaching or support to go along with it, is women who struggle with like diet mentality or have a tendency for all or nothing thinking or perfectionism, or who have like this conception that carbs are bad. And the only reason I say that is because potentially you need to work on your mindset as you are incorporating carbs, because carbs might trigger like either binge eating or falling off the wagon or negative self-talk or any of those things. So if that's you, just keep that in mind. All right. Okay. So I want to start by talking about why I think the five main reasons that I believe that carb cycling is really beneficial for women, and more so even for women in perimenopause, but for women in general. So the number one reason that for me, I think that it's beneficial is because it will help you to create a sustainable lifestyle. I don't believe there's any point in diets, to be perfectly honest. Don't go on a diet if you're just gonna go back to doing what you were doing prior to starting the diet, because all you're gonna do is lose and gain the same weight over and over again. So for me, it's not about a diet, right? Like when I do low carb or carb cycling or any of the things that I teach my clients, it's not about going on a diet until you reach your goal and then going back to your old habits. It's about establishing new habits. And carb cycling is such a great, sustainable, forever habit that can really help women create a low carb approach that they can do essentially for the rest of their life. And that's exactly what I plan to do. Number two, as I was kind of teasing this before, is that when you incorporate carb cycling, it just allows you to take low carb and make it a little bit more flexible, okay? So again, less restrictive, right? Less rules, being able to eat some of your favorite foods, ideally mainly whole foods, like, and we'll talk about the type of carbs, but also foods that may not be as good for you, like the pizza and the donuts and the ice cream, because we need to have a place for those things in our lives, because the more we restrict and we try to stop ourselves from eating those things, eventually we will. And then, well, that's when we can get ourselves into trouble, okay? The other reason that I really love carb cycling, and I want to do a topic on this at some point, but I really believe that it's a great way of incorporating more fiber into your nutrition. So low carb, my version of low carb is already quite high fiber, as my clients know. Lots of nuts, lots of seeds, lots of vegetables, like really big emphasis on fiber in my approach. That being said, typically speaking, what I see a lot of is that when women switch over to a low carb ketogenic diet, their fiber intake goes down, because a lot of our fiber comes from starchy vegetables and whole grains, and those two things get eliminated when you're going low carb keto. So incorporating carb cycling gives you that benefit of getting more fiber into your diet. And if you don't know why fiber is important, I will tell you that it will help you balance your hormones. It will help to feed the good bacteria in your gut. And that is essential if you want to feel good during perimenopause and if you want to lose weight. Okay, next up, supporting healthy hormones. So again, there are mixed opinions on this topic, but there are a lot of people who believe that going too low carb too long as a woman can be too stressful on the body, and it can have an impact on our hormones. Specifically speaking, your adrenals, your thyroid, it is criticized for triggering hypothyroidism or making it worse. The production of your sex hormones, so progesterone and estrogen. We actually need carbs to build those sex hormones. And when those sex hormones disappear, well, as you guys know, because we're going through perimenopause and menopause, we don't feel our best when we don't have those hormones. So those are the four sort of like main hormones that I kind of take into account when I'm thinking about carb cycling. But leptin is another one. If you go too low carb for too long, your body starts to ignore leptin, and we don't want that to happen. So carb cycling can help just resensitize our response to leptin, which is our satiety hormone, if that's a new one for you. And then finally, just supporting muscle mass growth. So again, for women our age, we are already prone to age-related muscle mass loss, especially if you are sedentary. And we need insulin in order to help build muscle. And we get insulin by eating carbohydrates. Carbohydrates will trigger the production of insulin, and insulin will help us to build muscle mass. In fact, there's one of the techniques that I'm going to talk about today is this concept of carb backloading. This is huge in the bodybuilding community. Bodybuilders who use a low carb approach but also want to build muscle mass will use carb cycling. Okay, so those are your top five reasons. Okay, any questions so far before I keep going, just on sort of like reasons for why you might want to consider carb cycling? And then I'm going to talk about some different ways of doing it and really focus most of my time on how I do it, okay? And take a little sip of my coffee. Okay, so different styles of carb cycling. There are numerous different ways of doing it. There's no right or wrong way. It's going to depend on your goals. It's going to depend on your mindset. It's going to depend on your lifestyle. So I'll give you some different options. And then again, I'm going to focus in on what I do because it's obviously the type of carb cycling that I know most about. Hi, Carol. Hi, Becky. I think I said hi, Becky, already. Okay, so the first one is this concept of diet variation. And I learned about diet variation from Dr. Pompa, and he specializes in sort of low carb, carb cycling, uses a lot of fasting for detoxification, and he suggests, he's not the only one that suggests this, that basically, and I've said this before, that your body is constantly adapting, right? Like that is the role of your metabolism, is to adapt. And a lot of people believe that if you do the same thing over and over and over again, your body will simply adapt. And once your body is adaptive, well, then there's no more progression. So this concept of diet variation is to simply switch up your eating style periodically so that your body is constantly being forced to adapt to the circumstances. And that's where we see growth and fat loss and muscle mass or whatever goals you're looking for. And so when it comes to diet variation, you can do it. I mean, there's so many different ways of doing it. You could do, for example, you could go with the seasons. So you could pick a season and be like, okay, for this season, I'm just going to stick to low carb. And then for maybe the summer when there's all this beautiful fruit, maybe you come out of ketosis and you enjoy the fruit from your farmer's market and you do that for a couple of months and then you go back into it. So that's one way of doing it, is just cycling. Now, I use diet variation a little bit differently. I don't really do it seasonally like that. My version of diet variation is more like dialing it up, dialing it down. There are just periods in my life where I either don't feel like doing keto for whatever reason, or a lower carb approach, or I'm going on vacation, or it's Christmas time. And I purposely understand that during those times of my life, I'm going to what I call dial it down. And dial it down mainly means that I'm not going to worry so much about my habits, and more carbs will naturally come into my life. So I'm naturally going through cycles where I just have more carbs. And it's okay, right? That's just what I do. So that's one thing you can do. Another approach that you can do is you can carb cycle to support your menstrual cycle. And so this is obviously much more female specific. And as I was saying, we need carbohydrates to build hormones, especially progesterone. And if you are in perimenopause, there's a pretty good chance that you have low levels of progesterone in relation to estrogen. any woman over the age of 35 likely has lower progesterone levels. It just starts to decline naturally, but we also start to experience anovulatory cycles where we don't ovulate. And if you don't ovulate, you don't produce progesterone. So, but we can produce them in our adrenals. So we need to kind of support the production of these hormones. Now, if you were to do something like that, then you could follow a sort of low carb approach, ketogenic approach most of your cycle. You would want to increase your intake of carbohydrates on days 11 to 14, which is when you ovulate and estrogen goes up. And then from days 17 to 28, which is when progesterone goes up and you're kind of building, like that's a building phase for your body. So you're just, again, supporting your body as it's trying to build. And so again, that's just cycling with your cycle. And I'm going to do a whole workshop on cycles and explaining exactly what's happening to your hormones, and we can dive into that further. But just to give you an idea, the other thing you can do is you can cycle your carbs around your workouts. This is a very easy way of doing it because you can kind of take the guesswork out of it. It's like, okay, today I'm working out, so I'm going to have more carbs either before my workout or after my workout or both, depending on how active you are. But basically just having those carbohydrates right around your workout and understanding that, you know, again, if you've been doing keto low carb for a long time and the idea of incorporating carbs freaks you out, like I want you to just kind of think and be logical about what's happening in your body. If you've been doing keto low carb for a long time, you have depleted all of the glycogen stores in your body. And so your liver is free of glycogen and your muscles are probably have plenty of room. So when you eat the carbohydrates right around your workout, most of those carbs are going to get used up during the workout or right after the workout. Your body is so primed to suck it up, mainly in your muscles, which is what we want for muscle mass. So really kind of thinking about how you can incorporate more carbs right around your workouts. And then the two different styles that I like to use are smart refeeds, which is where I incorporate more carbohydrates 2-3 times a week with my dinner, specifically with my dinner. And that's what I'm going to go into a little bit more. So I won't go into that too much right now, but that's what it looks like. So, and that's what my clients do after 21 days. I ask them to commit 21 days to low carb, and then we immediately start incorporating smart refeeds 2-3 times a week, just with dinner. And I'll tell you what that looks like. And then the other big thing that I do, so I'll do smart refeeds if I'm wanting to dial it up and lose a little weight. But when I'm in weight maintenance mode, which I'm in right now, then I incorporate even more carbohydrates. So my sort of like how, what I consider like my maintenance plan is essentially keto low carb for breakfast and lunch, and then always incorporating more carbohydrates with my dinner. And again, understanding that it's not a huge amount of carbs. It's not like a bowl of pasta. It's really just a small amount. So it's usually like a cupped handful or about half a cup. And again, I know I've depleted my glycogen stores because I've been doing low carb for such a long time. And so it's not like I have this buildup of glycogen in my liver, which means that when I eat a little bit of carbohydrates, like some sweet potatoes, number one, again, some of that energy I'm gonna use up immediately. The rest of it, my liver is just gonna suck it up and store it and probably use it overnight. It's not, and the reason I'm talking about liver is that women who have too many carbohydrates, what happens is the liver gets completely clogged and it can't take the carbs anymore. It can't store any more glycogen. It gets full. That's bad. That's when you start gaining weight, because then the excess carbs that you're eating get turned into triglycerides, which are basically it's fat, right? Triglycerides. It's a storage form of fat. Your liver can hold more triglycerides and so can your fat cells. So that's what happens when we're eating too many carbs. But we don't have to worry about that happening when we're carb cycling, because the liver isn't bunged up by the excess carbs of having constant carbs, if that makes sense. So those are the five different things. So again, diet variations. So having periods where you're doing low carb, periods where you kind of relax a little bit. Carb cycling for menstrual support. So just using carb cycling in order to improve signs and symptoms like PMS or cramping or estrogen dominance or whatever it may be. Pre or post workout carb cycling. So timing your carbs right around your workouts. Smart refeeds, which is periodically having it with your dinner throughout the week as an ongoing habit. And then maintenance, thinking about, for maintenance for me, it's about discovering your own unique tolerance for carbohydrates and seeing how many times you can incorporate it without gaining weight, essentially, is what it boils down to. Okay, so let me talk a little bit more about smart refeeds, because again, that is the form of carb cycling that I practice most often. And as I said, most of my meals are still what would be considered ketogenic. So I do a ton of vegetables. I have a palm-sized portion of protein. And typically speaking, I have about 2 to 3 servings of healthy fats, which is basically 2 to 3 tablespoons of fat. Olive oil, avocado oil, it might be butter, whatever it may be. So that's what most of my meals look like. And then a few times during the week, I will add in some carbohydrates with my dinner. I do it with my dinner specifically because I know that if I start eating carbs with breakfast, I'm gonna want carbs for the rest of the day. And so for me, I prefer to just have them with my dinner. And then once my meal is done, I clean the slate, end of meal, I start my fast. And when I wake up in the morning, I'm back in ketosis. Like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't affect it. I'm still producing ketones. So that's kind of what that looks like. The other benefit of having them in the evening is that carbohydrates can be really helpful for helping you to produce the building blocks of melatonin. So for the women who struggle with insomnia, like smart refeeds may be really beneficial for you. So what are smart carbs? So I talk about smart refeeds, and so that for me comes back to this idea of smart carbs. There are certain carbs you would suggest around workouts. I'm just gonna answer this one quickly. I would say it depends. So I would play around with different things. I would always go with smart carbs, which I'm about to talk about. It depends on the goal. I know, Chantel, you are wanting to build muscle because we've had a couple of conversations. You might do well with a very, what's the word? I'm trying to think of the word here. Very quickly digestible form of carbohydrate that will come like right through your, like you'll eat it and it'll basically get absorbed immediately as a pre-workout to give you an insulin boost when you're doing your weight training. And I can give you the name, it's escaping me now. There's a very specific type of sugar that you can put in your shakes, for example, that will give you that very fast acting insulin response. So that's what I would recommend for you, just because I know that we've talked a little bit. Yes, I'm losing my stomach, I know. That's a tricky one, Chantel, because the body's really bad at multitasking, but we can talk about that another day. It's almost like you gotta go through different periods of like focus, like pick a focus, work on that, then pick a different focus and work on that. Okay, so what are smart carbs? So smart carbs, you can think of smart carbs as basically whole, minimally processed, complex carbohydrates that are very high in fiber and that are slow to digest, right? We don't want to necessarily, again, eat, you know, pizza, ice cream, chocolate cake, whatever that may be. I'm not saying don't ever eat them, because life is worth living and sometimes a girl just wants a piece of chocolate cake, so you should eat it. But on most of the occasions that you're incorporating carbs, I want them to be these high fiber, slow digesting carbs. So that would be fruit. Any kind of fruit, including the tropical fruit, the bananas, the mango, the pineapple. Again, for me, what I do with that is I'll incorporate fruit into my dinner a lot. So I might do like, again, it's small portions, right? I'm not like having a ton of carbohydrates. So I might put more fruit in my salad, or I might make lettuce wrap fish tacos, but have like mango slices, right? So I'm getting some carbohydrates. It's still not a ton, it's just some. Also starchy vegetables. That's pretty much my favorite. And so that would be like sweet potatoes, beets, squash, any kind of squash, plantain. That's what I do with my family. Any kind of like paleo type carbohydrates, starchy carb. That's what my family mainly eats when it comes to eating carbohydrates with dinner. It's mainly root vegetables or rice or any kind of whole grain. But again, we're looking for minimally processed whole grains. So it could be rice, it could be quinoa, it could be, what are some ideas? Amaranth, bulgur, like think of those whole grains. Like ideally that's what you want to go for. Beans, lentils, and legumes. Beans, lentils, and legumes, like pretty much any book you read about menopause will tell you to eat more beans, legumes, and lentils. But if you're doing low carb, that makes it really challenging because although they're a great source of protein, they're also a great source of carbohydrates. So incorporating more of those into your sort of smart refeeds or when you're cycling carbs would be a great way of getting that, the addition of all the health benefits of beans and legumes into your diet. And then the last little one is something called resistant starch, which resistant starch is as the name implies, it's a type of carbohydrate that resists digestion. And what that means is that once it gets into your small intestine, it doesn't get digested and it makes it its way down to your large intestine where it feeds the good bacteria in your gut. So again, going back to that gut health, it can be really good for you. Some of my favorite forms of resistant starch are cooked and cooled. This is really important. White rice or potatoes of any kind, but they have to be cooled. That's how the resistant starch comes out. You can also get different flours. So you can get green banana flour, you can get plantain flour, you can get potato starch. Those are all different flours that you could play around with to incorporate smart carbs into your diet, right? So maybe it could be like green banana flour protein pancakes or something like that, right? So just, you can get pretty creative with what you're making with them. Okay, so those are the different ones that I would suggest eating. Again, I did make a cheat sheet for you guys so that you'll get all this information. How many servings? How often should I be carb cycling? This is where it's really hard to give an individual or a general response because it's so individual. It will depend on activity levels. It will depend on how insulin resistant you are. So women struggling with really bad insulin resistance or PCOS, they might have to limit how often they are adding in smart refeeds, but whereas women who are super active can probably get away with more. But as a general rule of thumb, I like to start with about 2 or 3 a week. 3 for active women, 2, 1 if you're sedentary, maybe even. Just start there and start playing around. And just kind of keep an eye on your weight. Like I said at the beginning, for some women who have hit a weight loss plateau and have been committed to low carb for a long period of time, having a carb refeed can actually help you bust through a weight loss plateau, because what can happen is that as your fat cells shrink, because you're using that stored fat as energy, the fat cells, they don't actually shrink, they fill up with water. And having that carb refeed can suck the water out of the fat cells, and then you pee it out when you deplete your glycogen stores, and you see this, it's called, often called as the whoosh effect. Think about when you originally started a low carb diet and you had that initial big weight loss. So the same thing can happen when you have that smart refeed occasionally. So you could try that. Another technique, this is another one, is that you have a smart refeed, and then once your scale goes 1 pound lighter, you have a smart refeed, 1 pound lighter, smart refeed. And it just helps to, again, give that little variation and pull all that possible water retention out of your body. Okay. How many carbs would I put in? So this is going to depend on how often you're cycling. So again, the way that I do it, I do like small refeeds throughout the week. There are different ways of doing this. You could do one big refeed. You could do a couple of moderate. I prefer to do small refeeds during the week. And so for me, that's like I said, a cup, handful, or half a cup. And that's really it. But some people prefer to do one big refeed. So they'll stick to low carb all week. And then say on a Saturday night, they have a big bowl of pasta, right? That's a different way of doing it. There's no right or wrong. You really need to play around and see what works most, like what works best for you. Okay, low carb for you is how many net grams, please? And when you eat more carbs, how many do you add approximately? Okay, so I don't count calories and I don't count macros, so to be perfectly honest, I have no idea. I know, I go by how I feel, but based on like what my knowledge is, I know that typically speaking, when I'm making a meal, there's less, like if I consider it low carb, it's probably gonna be 15 grams of net carbs or less in my meal. So if I'm eating three in a day, I still fall under 50 net, which is what is considered sort of the threshold for being in ketosis. Again, that is like, it's a very general number. Some women need to do less. Some women can get away with more. But that's my sort of rule of thumb is 50 or less. And because I'm eating three meals a day on most days, it works out to about 15 net carbs, which is total minus fiber, if that's a new term for you, a day. When I incorporate more carbs, I'm probably adding another 50 grams or so. So I'm probably ending up somewhere between 75 and 100 net carbs a day on days that I am cycling carbohydrates. I hope that answers that question. Okay, in my case, I lift weights and I think I never eat enough, even using Carb Manager to count my macros. Anna, that is definitely can be problematic if you're not eating enough. If you're not getting results, my guess is that is probably the main reason. Chronic caloric restriction will cause metabolic adaptation or a downregulation of the metabolism. I've talked about this a lot. So if you reach out to me, I'll send you a link to a video that you can watch to learn more about that. Okay, I have one more thing to share with you today, which is just tips for getting started for women who are thinking that this is something they want to start with. Number one, I would say commit to low carb for 21 days. So again, this is what I have been getting my clients to do for, I don't know, like 3-4 years now. Before I introduce carb cycling, I get them to commit to low carb. I want to do that for a couple of reasons. Number one, I want to make sure that we're depleting your glycogen stores completely, right? We want to get rid of all stored glycogen in the body so that then when we are eating carbohydrates, we're not clogging up the liver and we're not like kicking ourselves out of ketosis for 2-3 days. It's really just like 2-3 hours maybe. Overnight, whatever it may be, right? So it's just like a little like quick kick out. So doing it for 21 days. The other reason I like to do it for 21 days is because I want you to develop something called metabolic flexibility. So metabolic flexibility is your body's ability to burn carbs, fat, ketones, alcohol, whatever you give it, it burns. And when women are metabolically inflexible, they oftentimes cannot access their stored body fat. That is when we're considered inflexible. And by committing to low carb for 21 days, you force the body to figure it out. You force the body to figure out how to take fat and turn them into ketones for energy. And that makes it a lot easier to cycle carbs without seeing weight gain or without getting kicked out of ketosis for too long. And if women can't get through that period of adaptation, they can kind of get stuck in what's often referred to as keto flu or low carb flu, where they feel lousy because they're not giving their body enough carbs for their body to fuel on carbs. but they're not cutting them out enough for their body to know what to do with the fat, so they just get stuck in this crappy zone. Okay, sorry about that. I don't know what happened. I think we're back live. Okay, second tip for getting started is follow a structured plan. Do not wing it. Because this is what I do inside my program. Once again, is I give my clients a very structured program. They know when to add in smart refeeds. They plan for it. So it's not just like, I feel like carbs tonight, I'm gonna have some carbs. I do that now, but at the beginning, when you're first learning about it, it's best to just follow a structured plan, know when you're gonna do it. Like the same as any kind of plan, if you're winging it, you might be not as consistent as you think. Just follow something a bit more structured, like decide, commit, when are you gonna do your smart refeeds or your carb cycling, pick a plan, write it out, do it. And of course, again, as I said at the beginning, like, you know yourself, do you need to work on your mindset before you incorporate carb cycling? If you go ahead after this video and decide that tonight you're gonna have carbs, is it going to get you to fall off track for 2-3 weeks, 1 month? If so, don't start immediately. Maybe talk to me about getting some more support. But you know yourself, right? So really consider your mindset. If you're an all or nothing, or you have like a weird relationship with carbs, just keep that in mind. Start with smart carbs, not junk food. This is a really important one because it could be tempting to be like, okay, I'm gonna cycle some carbs and I'm gonna start with pizza. Well, that can really make you spiral out of control. So start with like almost like kind of plain carbs, like sweet potatoes or just plain old white rice, something that's not gonna make you want to, you know, overeat. That's a good way to do it. Then again, you can still incorporate sort of like the treats, just maybe don't start with them. I like to ease my clients when they first reincorporate carbs after they've cut them out for 21 days. It is not with ice cream. It's with like sweet potato or plain white rice. And then the final one, and this one is probably the most important, is do not worry about the scale. Because when you start carb cycling, your weight is gonna be all over the place. It's gonna go up, it's gonna go down, based on like how much water you're retaining when you drop it. It's gonna be all over the place. And so if you have a relationship with the scale that triggers your decisions for the rest of the day, I would say if you're gonna incorporate carb cycling, you either have to weigh in every single day and look at your weekly average. I talked about this in a video using an app called Happy Scale, or do not step on the scale for at least 3 days until after you have carb cycled. Because if not, you're gonna be like, Haley is crazy and she's making me gain weight. It's not, it's just momentary. So there you have it. I'm gonna open it up for questions if you guys have any. And I will let you know how to grab the cheat sheet for this one. And let's just see if there's any other questions. And I'll just make sure I didn't miss any. I'm just gonna scroll up here. Okay, I see that Bridget asked, how does it help with weight loss? I hope I answered that one for you, Bridget. It's really about, again, it's varying it up, right? Making sure the body isn't adapting and also pulling possibly some of the water that's trapped in your fat cells. Okay, I think I covered that. So we talked about that. I think I caught them all. Got that one. Okay. I think that's it. So if you guys do not have any questions, that is what I have for you today. If anything comes up, you can always reach out to me. I will be taking the next 4 days off, so you won't get the cheat sheet anytime soon. I've got it ready, but getting it out to you guys is another sort of situation. I just have to figure out how to get it to you. Sometime next week you will hear from me and I will get that to you. So there you have it. Thank you for watching. Happy Easter. I hope you all have a wonderful weekend. And I know I will be having a little bit of chocolate on Sunday. And I hope you do too. Bye.